to welcome you here to this first plenary session of this conference with the title Women versus Men in Sport and Exercise. And when I read that title, I immediately had the association with a time in primary school where we did games playing boys against girls. And I'm sure that you also have this competitive side that is brought out by this title. So I'm hoping that you will not be completely disappointed at the end of this session. You will not know which gender is better, but I'm quite sure that many, many gender differences will be pointed out. And it's my very great pleasure to introduce Professor Wendy Brown as the first speaker in this session. Professor Brown works at the School of Human Movement Studies of the University of Queensland at the beautiful St. Lucia campus in Brisbane, Australia. Wendy is a renowned researcher in the field of physical activity and public health and has received many, many research grants and published a great number of papers in international journals. And not only is she a great researcher in this field, she also spends much of her time translating research results into policy. And she's very active in policy development, both nationally in Australia as internationally. And in addition to all her work in the broad field of physical activity and public health, much of her research has been on health and well-being of Australian women. She was one of the founders of the Australian Longitudinal Study of Women's Health, and that's a project in which the health of over 40,000 women has been tracked over more than 10 years by now. And today, Wendy will speak about gender differences in physical activity and sitting and how these relate to gender differences in health outcomes. And we will hear from Wendy if the men are always on top or not. The floor is yours, Wendy.
Thank you very much, Mirai. I'm very honored to be invited to present in this opening session of this Congress. Thank you to the conference organizers for inviting me. I'm going to talk about gender differences, as Mirai said, and the talk will have three themes. I'm going to look at population levels of physical activity and sitting time, their relationships with health, and then some conjecture about current changes in patterns over time. Starting with the first theme, I'm going to look at physical activity prevalence in women and men. And most of you will know that most population data sets suggest that men are more active than women. If we look at the Lancet series, which was published in 2012, we see from a study of data from 122 countries in the World Health Organization data repository, from people who answered questions about mostly leisure and transport physical activity with limited questions about work, we saw that men are slightly more active than women across the range of countries from low income to high income. The range is not as large as you might have thought it was, and it's actually highest in the high income countries, so countries like the Netherlands where we are now. However, if we look at vigorous activity, the proportion reporting doing vigorous activity three times a week shows a much greater sex difference, and clearly here, at all ages, men are more active than women. If we look, however, at the prevalence of physical activity in the US, using the most recent data from their BRFSS system, the dark blue here is the higher levels of physical activity, and the green is in the middle, and the yellow are low levels, and you can see some low levels here, this is a very sensitive pad, in these southern states of the US, levels of physical activity in women were quite low in 2011, and lower than in men. But if we look at changes over time in physical activity in the US, this graph, the blue, is showing greater change, and you can see there's probably more blue spots on the women's side of this graph, and that probably indicates that women in the US are catching up with the men. And it may reflect the fact that they were at a lower starting point, so in states over there like Kentucky and South Dakota, you can see there's quite a big change in physical activity. However, if we look at physical activity levels in Australia, we get a slightly different picture. These are data from our National Health Survey, the most recent one in 2012, and we can see that across the lifespan from 18 to 24 right through to 75 or up to 75 years, there's a decrease in physical activity over time, but it's really only in the youngest and the oldest groups where there's a clear sex difference, with men being more active than women. So at least in Australia, it seems that across the middle age range, the women are catching up. And Mirai mentioned the Australian Longitudinal Study for Women's Health. I'm going to talk quite a lot about this study today. We're following the health of about 40,000 women. We've actually been going for 17 years, not 10, Mirai. And I'm feeling very old because of it. But we can see physical activity levels here in young women. This is from in their 20s and early 30s are declining as expected. And also in older women in their 70s and 80s, levels are declining. So this follows the trend we expect. But in middle-aged women, physical activity levels have increased over the last 17 years. And it seems to point again to these middle-aged women who are catching up with the men. So a very quick summary of physical activity prevalence. We can see that men are more active than women across countries in all income strata. Data from the US suggests women are catching up. Data from Australia show middle-aged women have caught up, and the sex differences in physical activity prevalence now seem to differ by age. So if we look now at sitting time, what's happening with sitting time, differences between men and women, well, the data are much less consistent. If we look at Australian data, this graph shows sitting time in hours per week from young adults through to older adults. And you can see there that across the age range of working adults, so 20s, 30s, 40s and 50s, men tend to sit more than women. Now these are self-reported data, and there may of course be differences in the way that men and women report their sitting, but it certainly looks like men sit more than women, men of working age. If we look at objectively measured sitting time, these are data that Jen Healy extracted from the NHANES dataset 2003 to 2006, we can see that sitting time is quite variable, but it's not very different between men and women. There's this kind of steady level of sitting time until about 50 or 60, and then it increases markedly in both men and women. Across working age adults, most sit between 7.5 and 9 hours per day between these bars, men and women. And the only group who are counter to that trend are these Mexican-American men, who have lower levels of sitting time throughout their working life. And immediately we think, well, is this really a gender difference, a sex difference, or is it because they do different sorts of paid work? And in the research that I do, I like to think of people's jobs as those that are described by people themselves as, I sit all day, or I'm on my feet all day. And these two descriptions can really apply to men and women and largely determine how much sitting time there is during the day. So if we look at sitting and work patterns in Australian women, this is an older study of ours, we see that full-time working men sit quite a lot in leisure time and at work and of course in getting to and from work. These are Australian data. Full-time working women sit a little less, but women who work part-time in the paid workforce obviously don't sit as much because they're not there as often. And women who are in home duties hardly sit at all. These are women at home, usually with young children. So we can see that sitting time patterns largely reflect occupational status rather than gender. So there are a few measures of sex differences in objectively measured sitting time across all domains of sitting, transport, work, and leisure. And total daily sitting time seems to be driven by work-related sitting. There seems to be little difference in total daily sitting time between men and women who do the same kind of work. And in fact, it could be important to look at both combinations of sitting and physical activity when we're considering health outcomes. So in our longitudinal study, we've started now to categorise our women as being at risk. If they sit for more than 7 hours a day, you might like to contemplate on this as you go through the next few days of being at this conference, sitting for more than 7 hours a day and doing less than 600 minutes of leisure time physical activity, which is considered meeting guidelines. And we see the ones that are most likely to be inactive and sit a lot are these white-collar workers, administrative and secretarial workers, and the ones who are least likely to be in this risk category are the blue-collar workers who are on their feet and have more leisure time. So we find that blue-collar workers, especially in Australia now, have more free time and often more money to invest in leisure time physical activity. So if we move on now and look at the relationships between physical activity and sitting time and health outcomes, are they the same in women and men? Starting with physical activity, you all know this evidence from cohort studies, whether it's Jeremy Morris's bus drivers, postmen, civil servants, Ralph Paffenbarger's longshoremen, Harvard alumni, Swedish men, Italian train drivers, the Cooper Clinic cohort, which was largely men, they all show the same pattern of risk reduction. The more physical activity you do, the lower the cardiovascular disease mortality. And most of these data were published in the 1980s and 90s, so we've known this for a long time. There is also evidence from women's cohort studies, most notably the three large ones in the US, the nurses, the Women's Health Study, and the Women's Health Initiative. And our review of that work in 2007 showed pretty much the same pattern, except that on this graph it's showing walking level on the x-axis, and this shows that the more walking women report, the lower their risk of cardiovascular disease. And you can see some quite low levels of risk here, actually lower than the ones that were noted in the previous graph for men. So that starts to give us a clue about what's coming next. And that's roughly meeting guidelines as levels 4 and 5 of walking. But the relationships between physical activity and health have rarely been examined in men and women using the same categories of physical activity and the same referent categories. Because, of course, when we talk about relevant risk, we need to have a reference. We did this in a paper published a couple of years ago in British Journal of Sports Medicine. So we looked at physical activity and mortality in the older cohort of the Australian longitudinal study of women's health. So these are data from about 7,000 women who were followed for 10.4 years on average. And we see this typical dose-response relationship with a very, very large drop in risk of death over 10 years in women who report some activity compared with those who do none. For women who do more activity, as we move across here, you see the risk declines, and that's a fairly typical pattern. And when we analyse these data differently, by using continuous data and smoothing the graph, and instead of using this as the referent point, so women doing none, in this case we made the reference, this point of 500 met minutes a week, which is consistent with the lower level of the current physical activity guidelines in Australia. So compared with women who report 500 met minutes of physical activity a week, women who do less than that have increased risk, and women who do more have decreased risk. But the surprise finding here was that when we plotted the data from a similar cohort of older men in Western Australia, we found that their curve was up here. So this means that compared with women who meet guidelines, men who meet guidelines have 2.5 times increased risk of dying over 10 years. Men who don't do any activity have almost a threefold increase, and those who do lots and lots and lots of activity are still twice as likely to die as women who meet guidelines. So there's a clear gender difference in the relationship between physical activity and health when the same reference point is used. I guess this raises the issue of whether we should look at relative risks or absolute risks of dying. And my colleague Annette Dobson led this paper from the same data set. Now, it's a little complicated, so I'll try to explain it slowly. We looked at different age groups, and I'm just using the 71 to 73-year-olds here because, of course, risk of dying increases with age. But amongst 71 to 73-year-olds, men and women who are in the lowest risk group, now pay attention here, the lowest risk group are those who drink alcohol more than weekly, never smoked, and are overweight at this age. These are the things you should be doing. And if you do that and you're inactive, and you're a man, your risk of dying is almost double that of a woman. but if you're active, your risk of dying is reduced. It still stays double that of women, but there's a 5% advantage between being inactive and active if you have no other risk factors. However, if you're on the other side of this graph and in the highest risk group, which means you drink alcohol less than weekly, you're a current smoker and obese, so these are things we shouldn't be doing, some surprises there, I think, we find that the risks are much, much higher. In fact, men who are in these high risk categories and inactive, the risk is 53 per 1,000 likelihood of death. And there's still a remarkable sex difference here, but again, there's a 10% advantage for active men. So if you're working with older men, it's very, very important not only to address these risk factors, to move them from here to here, but also to address activity and to try to move them down across here so that their risk will become more like the risk we see in women. I could only find one study which looked at a meta-analysis of the difference between the relationship, physical activity and risk of coronary heart disease in men and women. And this is from Aimin Lee's group, one of her PhD students, published a couple of years ago. They looked at 33 studies, only 9 of which had data which were exactly the same in men and women. And the men's data looked like this. Compared with men who do no physical activity, those who do 150 minutes, the bottom end of the current guidelines, had a reduced risk of cardiovascular disease, and the ones who did 300 minutes a week, which is the upper limit of our guidelines, had further reduced risk. And this group over here are doing 5 times recommended guidelines, and there isn't much increase in doing that. And when the data from the women in the 9 studies, which were exactly the same, plotted on the same graph, they look like this. So the risk in women is very much lower at the bottom end of guidelines, at the top end of guidelines. And for women who are doing 5 times the amount recommended, there's a huge reduction in risk of cardiovascular disease. So there's obviously something different happening here between women and men. And the relationship is stronger in women per volume of physical activity. But it made me think about which activities are counted in these studies. Now, most surveys of physical activity count walking for transport and cycling for transport, and almost all of them count moderate and vigorous leisure time physical activities. But what about activity in yard work? Now, this is a strong advocate of yard work for women in this picture. Some of you might recognise Jane Blair, who still mows the grass at the Blair household in South Carolina and believes it is very good for her health. But questions about gardening and yard work are rarely included. Occupational activity is asked in some surveys, but it seems to differ. If it's paid work, it's included. If it's unpaid work, it often isn't. So what about domestic work? For many reasons, it has been excluded on the whole from physical activity surveys. And there are some reasons for this. We know that household management energy expenditure has decreased in the last 50 years. These are data from Steve Blair's group. And we can see that, nonetheless, in the last 20 years or 30 years, or 20 years from 1990, energy expenditure in household tasks among women in the US is 3,000 kilocalories a week. This is a lot more than they're expending in leisure time physical activity. So maybe some of the reduced risk is coming from the extra activity that's not counted in the previous analyses I explained to you. I did ask the group in South Carolina about the men. I said, where are the data for men and household management? And they laughed and said, well, I'm sorry, but they're not on the scale. And I said, well, you know, you can do better than that. And I think Steve said he thought about maybe 300 kilocalories. So come on, guys from the US, you've got to do better. We know that at least in Northern Ireland, men are doing housework. Here's the data from Marie Murphy. This is the proportion of total moderate to vigorous physical activity that is housework. And you can see these are data for men, and it increases with age up to the age of about 70, and then falls. However, the data for women are very, very much higher, as I'm sure many women in the audience will know. And so it's not surprising that by the time we get to retirement, we have cartoons like this, and clear differences in physical activity between older men and older women. And this year, in British Journal of Sports, met our paper on the contribution of house and garden work to the association between physical activity and well-being was published. This is work led by Felicia Peters. It's a complex graph, but if you look carefully at this, this is leisure time physical activity and physical health on the SF36, and this is mental health. We've got three lines here. This is a young cohort, about 9,000 young women, aged 25 to 30, 11,000 mid-aged women, 50 to 55, and 8,000 older women, aged 76 to 81. And you can see physical health is higher in young women, that's not surprising, but the reverse is true for mental health. The mental health of older women is higher than for mid-age and young women. But nonetheless, there is a relationship with physical activity, and it's very strong in older women. That's leisure time physical activity. But when we looked at the relationship with house and garden work, we found quite a different pattern. So in the young and middle-age cohort, it seems that the more housework you do, the worse your health, and the same for mental health. Now this is very complex, and I'm not going to even try and describe it today, but from my experience, I think it has something to do with children and getting them to help and being having to do all of the household activities, and maybe we see changes when the children leave home, but I'm guessing. But let's focus on the older cohort, where we've got quite strong relationships between physical activity and levels of house and garden work, and that's both physical and mental health. So one of my PhD students, Nico Aguilar, just this year, has been measuring energy expenditure of household tasks in old people over 75 to 100 years. And older people doing things around the garden, trimming hedges, sweeping, raking, even mowing the grass, and inside doing a range of activities. This is Cyril, he's 100 years old and he still does all the ironing. And we found that the MET values of these tasks inside the house range from about 2 to 3.2 compared with 3.5 for walking. So there's a fair bit of activity inside the house and a fair bit of energy expenditure because of the hours spent doing these things each day. And outside, the MET values range from 2.4 to 5 for mowing the grass. So Jane, keep up the lawn mowing, it's 5 METs and it's doing you a lot of good. So the relationship between physical activity and health and the difference between women and men may be explained by the omission of household tasks from our population surveys, especially in those groups of older people where household work constitutes a high proportion of daily energy expenditure. So let's have a look at sitting time and health outcomes now. Very few data have compared women and men. And I'd like to thank Bethany Howard, who's a PhD student from Melbourne, who kindly let me use this meta-analysis, which is work in progress, and she hasn't finished the analysis yet, but each study is represented twice, and it's exactly the same measures for women and men. But if you look at the comparison, say the top one here and here, or this one here and here, they're pretty much the same for women and men, with the exception of this study from Peter Katzmarchik, you may know it, the one from Canada with 10 years of follow-up, showing that sitting is not very good for us, and the relationship may be a little bit stronger in women, but you can see here that the intervals are very wide and probably overlapping. But this is work in progress, so we don't know. And the difficulty with this work is there's so many domains of sitting time and so many different measures that it's very difficult to do meta-analytical work. We do know, however, that high sitting time, more than about 9 hours a day, is associated with increased mortality in women and men. TV time is associated with adverse health outcomes in women and men. But there have been very few studies of total sitting time and health in men and women with the same measures and with proper adjustment for total physical activity. So I'm not able to tell you very much more about sitting and health and the differences at this time. But what's happening with patterns of physical activity and they're changing over time? I'm sure many of you sitting in the audience are thinking, oh, this isn't true, all you men are doing the housework and the women probably are not. Things are changing, and I wonder how changes in these patterns of physical activity and sitting time might relate to health outcomes. Well, patterns of sitting and activity are definitely changing. We can see that men are moving into what would have once been considered men's jobs. So in Australia, a lot of women are taking driving jobs in the mining industry, and apparently they're much better at it than men. They have fewer accidents. But we see some opposite trends in some countries in work which has been the domain of women, such as production work. We can see sometimes that some men are starting to do this work, but interestingly, in this picture, the only man is standing up. I wonder if he's been looking at the sitting epidemiology literature in his spare time, but the women over here are looking a bit aghast at the fact that he is standing. But I think the situation about changing in patterns of physical activity is summed up by this work from Elizabeth McClintock in the US, who said that married or cohabiting men who switch to occupations that traditionally have been dominated by women, such as teaching, nursing, or childcare, may spend more time doing housework than men who are in more traditional male-dominated fields. Whether their wives or partners spend less time doing the housework compared with the spouses or partners of men who work in more heavily male occupations. So I wonder, this big difference in physical activity and mortality between women and men, obviously there are lots of biological and genetic differences here, but I wonder if men's and women's physical activity and sitting patterns continue to become more similar, as they are doing in many Western developed countries, will we see a reduction in this gap in health outcomes if we start to measure these behaviours accurately and objectively, and we can include all the domains? Patterns of sitting and activity are changing. We can't change men into women, although some have tried. Do you recognise that? It's a doubtfire. And I wonder, if men were to take on a greater share of domestic work, would our studies show improved health outcomes for men? This is a cartoon that came out in our local paper when my first study on physical activity epidemiology was published in the 1990s. And what the man is saying at the back there is, what did I tell you? Your health problems are caused by lack of exercise, which was something, I guess, that we claimed in the paper. But I wonder, looking back now, is it that his health problems are exacerbated by a lack of housework? Maybe. So, in summary, have I kept to time? Most studies show that men are more active than women, especially if domestic work is not counted as physical activity. Sitting time seems to vary more by occupational role than by gender. And relationships between physical activity and health are more marked in women, stronger in women than in men. So I think it's even more important to encourage men to be more active in all domains of activity, including domestic work. I'd like to acknowledge my colleagues in the Centre for Research on Exercise, Physical Activity and Health for helping me with a lot of these studies, my colleagues in the Centre for Life, Longitudinal and Life Course Research, and the two students who let me use their unpublished data. Thank you.
Sticking to time so very well, and that gives us time actually for two or three short questions. Anyone in the audience? No questions? Yes, down here.
Janice Thompson, University of Birmingham, UK. Thank you, Wendy. That was a great talk. I have a question about the household intensity. I'm not sure if you've seen the paper, it's been out a number of years now by, I think Stomaticus was the lead author, Melvin Hilsden was working with him, about how domestic housework actually isn't going to be contributing a high enough intensity to enhance our health. So I don't know how you're thinking of that, although you've got some nice, well-measured intensity data from Australia, particularly in older adults. So what do you think about that comment that maybe women should just go out and exercise and stop cleaning the house, which sounds really great to me.
Leave the men to clean the house, sounds even better. I think it depends on how you define health benefits. I mean, these are cardiovascular, most of these studies are looking at cardiovascular disease or mortality per se, of all causes. And I think it's true to say that exercise physiologists particularly have tended not to count light intensity physical activity, and I do believe it's really important. If you spend 7 hours a day doing activity at 2.9 minutes, which you might not count in a traditional physical activity measure, that's going to have health benefits. So I think these household activities, we've also measured them objectively in young women in their 20s, and they're working about 2.5 to 3.5, 4 minutes during the day. On their feet, 8, 9, 10 hours a day, it has to make a difference to their health compared with people like academics who sit at their desks for, I don't know, what, 10 hours a day. But it's the combination of sitting time and physical activity that's important.
So would you, do you think that it would be important and useful for us to now start reporting light and moderate to vigorous physical activity as well?
Absolutely. Yeah. So, and accelerometer data will let us do this, and we'll be able to get the combinations of high sitting and low activity, and I think that's what's going to be important.
Thank you.
Wendy, based on your presentation and your data, would you be pleading for changing the physical activity guidelines?
I wouldn't be pleading for any changes because in Australia we just changed them. I'm sorry I don't have the slides here, but in Australia we just changed our physical activity guidelines, so our guidelines are now a little at odds with the rest of the world. We still say you should be doing 150 minutes of at least moderate intensity physical activity per week, but we actually have stretched our guidelines up to 300 minutes per week. So we're encouraging the Australian population to do what works out as, you know, between about 45 minutes or 1 hour per day. So it's a range. But I think we also acknowledge that doing any physical activity is better than none. So light intensity activities are going to be really important. And I know a lot of you are working in the sitting light activity space. And I'm sure that in the next couple of years, we're going to have lots and lots of studies that have prospective cohort data looking over time at different intensities. And because we spend such a large proportion of our day in light activity, it is going to be important.
Thank you very much for that.
Thank you.